Excellent.
Amen.
I'm so pleased that you could join us. Well, with that, are you able to share your slides with us? Because
Yes,
we've not had a chance to get you prepped behind the scenes.
I think I will try to share. Okay. Compartir aquí. Compartir pantalla. Vamos a ver si soy capaz de compartir la ventana.
Thank you for bearing with us, everybody behind the scenes. It's fantastic you're able to join us too.
Can you see it?
I see it, and here it comes, and I hand over to you to tell us all about it.
1, 2, 3, Perfect.
Yes, please go ahead. We can hear you and see you well. Would you like to share those again? It's just on
So
the screen.
can I use the presentation right now?
Yes, we're ready for you to start to give the presentation if you'd like to go. If you'd like to share that with us again,
Of
I'll get
course.
that back up on stage for you.
Thank you so much. So
Here we go. Okay, please go ahead.
thank you so much, dear friends. I apologize for the delay, but my presentation is entitled Toward the Establishment of a New Open Source Geospatial Remote Sensing Virtual Research Environments for eBiodiversity Ecosystem Services and Climate Change Modeling Adaptation. Well, it's a little bit long, but you will understand why. So I am talking here not only on my behalf, but also on behalf of the people of Lightwatch ERIC, that is the EU Science European Research Infrastructure on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Research. In fact, we got connections there. There are a lot of connections with Leiden, as you know well, with our colleagues from Naturalis, University of Amsterdam, as well with Buenos Aires, many people worldwide. And so I will explain to you later. And this presentation, focusing on the geospatial observation, will be very interesting from the point of view of how to show open source developments as a consequence of many, many developments, many, many developments that co-design and co-deployed during many years. So I'm going to try to move that. Here we are. Well, all of us have clear ideas about that we are living in certain ecosystems, co-sharing, coexisting with species, with factors of scale, time and evolution, DNA, proteins, and genes. And that there are five big, there is a few five hot ecological topics. We are talking about biodiversity, ecosystem functioning, climate change, habitat fragmentation loss, invasive animal species, compound impacts. But also take into account that all the nature, all the system, all the earth system can be considered as a complex system to model, take into account what is hydrosphere, lithosphere, atmosphere, and the high nonlinear processes happening over there. And this is important to address this complexity because we need to, in turn, address the big environmental challenges and support knowledge-based strategic solutions to environmental preservation, in particular, the biodiversity loss that we are experiencing in a context of more than evident climate change. So, I will go step by step. I'm going to explain you, introduce what is about the ecosystem services cascade from biodiversity to human well-being. What is true, what is very clear, is that we need to assess and monitor the ecosystem functions, the ecological processes, and the biodiversity upon humans' well-being depends on. What I mean, we go to biodiversity and ecological processes, and we need to understand how the ecosystem functions are working in order to further provide sustainable ecosystem services to guarantee the benefits for humans and preservation of the entire Earth system. You maybe know better than me that there is a big sister initiative called IBES, the Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, and there are a new model paradigm of the economics of biodiversity and ecosystems, the so-called TEB, since 2010. Because we need to understand, based on this new paradigm, the environment limits ecosystem resilience and relationships among biodiversity and essential ecosystem services. We need to understand that to provide to make a feedback, a proper feedback to preserve and to live in harmony with nature. Based on observations. Based on observations of what? Well, as you know well, sustainable development goals are not big per se. They are there in order to guarantee the human well-being. And the human well-being is related to the preservation of nature and the coexistence with nature. And that coexistence of nature depends on the way we understand the ecosystem functions and the services that are working there. And now how we can feedback with the provision of the proper sustainable ecosystem services. As you can see here, we have identified a matrix. You know, on the one hand and one axis, you can see the identification of certain sustainable development goals, and on the other, the assessment of 12 key ecosystem services by a survey of experts identifying a minimum of 231 strong dependencies of sustainable development goals targets on a multiple ecosystem services. Well, see the legend on the right, please. Level of support for a contribution. Many of them are not certainly well assessed yet. So we need to be based on fair data, findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable, which are the basis of scientific evidence to understand how to guarantee in a proper way this tacit knowledge derived from the fact of how we can we provide these sustainable development goals. Well, and these ecosystem-based approaches must be based through an urgent and concerted force fostering transformative change, and transformative change in which policy making, institutional processes, and regulatory framework. At the same time that society capacitation and knowledgement, economic systems, and ecosystem and natural resource management are working all over together. All together. And this is like what Eric about. Like what Eric is about a European e-science distributed infrastructure on biodiversity and ecosystem research. In order to create this regulatory framework, this framework, in order to understand what is going on, what's the impact of global climate change on Earth biodiversity and ecosystem research as a structuring tool of the European research area by means of providing the state of art of ICT with data, deep learning, artificial intelligence, edge computing, blockchain, man in an organized manner. What do I mean? What I mean is that based on the global biodiversity informatics outlooks, by my colleague and dear friend Hoven et al. In 2012, like what Eric is on the top in layer on the understanding based on the culture, data, and scientific evidence, on understanding from the point of view of how can we can build model representations of biodiversity patterns and properties based on any possible evidence, and in turn based on the following components: multi-scale space modeling, trends and predictions, modeling biological systems, visualization dissemination, prioritizing new data capture. And all of this, we can put together all of them into, let's say, software systems. The so-called Tesseract is very funny why we decide to call Tesseract the evolution of a cube, a meta cube. It's Tesseract. That's a new model, new paradigm of virtual research environments, and life block chain system, our system, not only addressed to citation, data citation, provenance, anti-tampering, but also tokenization, socioeconomics tokenization of ecosystem services. Now I'm going to the observations, step by step. Well, because of this, because of that, since 17 of March of 2017, we are considered as AERIC, as European e-science, European research infrastructure for biodiversity research, composed for 13 number of member states from the European Union, based on the council regulation. At the moment, we are Belgium, Bulgaria, Greece, Spain, Italy, the Netherlands, Portugal, Slovenia, and almost to be full member, Cyprus, Republic of Ireland, Israel, Slovakia, Ukraine, and Romania. We have our headquarters and the main ICT coordination office here in Spain, Andalusia region, Seville and Malaga. Today we are here in Malaga. The service center is in the region of Puglia, in Italy, in the southern Italy. And the Virtual Labs and Innovation Center is settled in Amsterdam, the Netherlands, without forgetting the regional components of the European Union, as you know as well. And we are not working alone, of course. We are working with our sisters and brothers from the Global Biodiversity Information Facility, GBIF, the Research Data Alliance, Copernicus, the European Green Deal, the European Open Science Cloud, the famous EOS you maybe heard about. And not only, there are a lot of them. I couldn't stop all night telling you, all night, all day, there in Buenos Aires, all the people. At the same time, now we have been explicitly requested by the European Commission about the Green Deal chapter. And one of the Green Deal chapters, in turn, is the biodiversity chapter. Biodiversity, because biodiversity is everywhere. It's about the ecosystems providing food, fresh water, clean air, and shelter, and mitigating natural disasters, pests and disease, and help regulate the climate. That's clear. At the same time, we are experiencing in Europe and throughout all the world a new digitization process. This is the case of Industry 4.0 towards a 5.0 industrialization in Europe, where digital innovation hubs, regulation, skill platform are coming all together, taking into account that the quadruple helix of innovation, where academy, private companies, including small and medium companies, civil society organizations, must come all together in a transdisciplinary way to understand what is going on. It's not about pure research. Research data cannot be in a box, isolated there. Decision makers must take affordable, reliable decision-making processes for preservation of environment based on those data. Entrepreneurs, ICT, environmental companies must take decisions on that. And citizen scientists must be aware of the importance of preservation of the environment by including an intergenerational approach from the elderly people to children. That's clear. So, capacity building is essential. We need to create knowledge catalog, training, education, increased volume, mapping, strategy, research area, competence and skills, and always thinking that the psychology of the people are different because they got different approaches to the problem of biodiversity and ecosystem preservation. It's not the same approach of a researcher, a public administration decision maker, an entrepreneur, or citizen scientist. That's more clear. We must satisfy the user's requirement worldwide on the fact of that indigenous knowledge for one side or the globalization are affecting in different ways from the knowledge, organizational knowledge way, the way we tackle with the problem of preservation, biodiversity, and ecosystem services. That's the reason that we are having identified that one of the first priority research infrastructure from the EULAC, the European Union Latin American Caribbean Working Group. These are some nice pictures in Doñana, here in Andalusia, there in Costa Rica. And at the same time, we are leaders, let's say, in the subgroup from Green Deal issues to foster the creation of a partnership from green transition and energy access between the European Union and the African Union. In fact, the G7 agenda conclusions and the forthcoming COP27 illustrate the biodiversity as a vital and critical component of the European Union public policy agenda in Europe and globally in Europe for the future. What does it mean? Together we are strong. We cannot face global challenges of climate change alone. And here we go. This is a conceptual paper signed by myself, Dimitris Kouvreas, Walter Adding, Tim Hirsch, Christos Armentidis, Tony José Sáenz Albanés, Peter Schork. They are wiser than me in the field of e-biodiversity. Facing e-biodiversity challenges together, a GBIO framework based on how GBIF, DISCO, IDATBIO, CETAF, TDWG, and Lightwatch Eric, we have agreed to deal with the challenge of preservation of biodiversity based on the best state of art of ICT. And step by step, my friends, I will go to the observations. A little bit of patience. Let's go. Again, the select and light block. Why? Because you can see this skin on the right, on the left. I don't know if you can see with enough resolution. You go there, citizens, government, entrepreneurship, researchers, that's right. On the other hand, you got essential biodiversity variables, agroecology, environment, socioeconomic domains, and then you got different ICT here components. And you need to find a way, in a user-friendly way, to provide to the users on the top, researchers, decision makers, entrepreneurs, citizen scientists, what they need. One of those components is related to remote sensing, is related to observations, and how through those tools we can compose the proper workflow services through the semantic composition
mechanisms, taking into account that on one side we got a blockchain system to have the traceability of the resources that we are engaging in a distributed manner, databases, software, publication, media, or a certain thematic topic. And at the same time, we need to guarantee the connection to the big pipe of the cloud computing, to the European Open Science Cloud, or either Open Science Cloud, or either the EuroHPC, the supercomputing, when they need to launch any process for modeling, any supercomputing requirement. So, resources layer, infrastructure layer, composition layer, application layer, and finally the user layer. Step by step. This is about Tesseract. But let's go a little bit step forward. We need to tackle with the problems, the perspective of the scale and heterogeneity challenges. What that means? We're talking the scale, micro, meso, macro scale, biodiversity. It's not the same to measure with a nano or micro sensor, something that is little, a bit. As you know well, the 96% of the biodiversity in the world is microbial. Bacteria, virus, fungi, etc. Many fungi. The mesoscale is the world we're living in. The macro, we're approaching to the geoscale, to the observations. And then the heterogeneity nature of data and metadata resources involved. It's not the same analyzing with remote sensing we are doing every day and how to connect to create synergies with environmental on field samples, our annotations in a notebook on the field. Climate change monitoring, environmental observation networks, working data on green data and agroecology in this Latin American, Caribbean, and Africa context by promoting those tools based on two paradigms, green and blue initiatives. And this is a very conceptual scheme based on the Mediterranean forest on how we can do this from the perspective of a nanosensor, microsensor, till the mesoscale, the coordination of the edge computing based on edge computing techniques, and the combination finally with the remote sensing. And the remote sensing, why? Because from the perspective of the Earth observation, we're talking about oceans, land, air. We're talking about how to measure in oceans, chlorophyll, salinity, surface temperature, how in the land, how we can measure net primarity productivity, the NPP. From the air perspective, aerosols, rainforest, snow, night lights, light pollution, more important than the people think, believe me, my friends. And how from the under the umbrella of United Nations, we can foster the collaboration through the Space for Sustainable Development Goals objective. Because as the former Secretary General and the current Antonio Guterres, Secretary General of the United Nations, said, we must challenge climate change skeptics who deny the facts. We need to guarantee that safe operation space for humanity, planet boundaries, and geoscience, remote observations are essential. The people today here, you are essential to understand in a global way how it's affecting every part locally. Why? Because the remote sensing and net observations from the geopolitical scope allows to compare different geopolitical scenarios in different parts of the world, facilitates the development of Europe to collaborate with other countries. It's very important. Taking consideration the successful developments of GeoVON initiatives, the group of Earth observations by the Biodiversity Observation Network, we are a partner with United Nations Outer Office Space Agency, UNOS Initiative, Copernicus, NASA, and last but not least, the one which is gathering all of them, Space for Sustainable Development Goals objectives. This is an example of remote sensing across borders on this observation and now open source scaling, step by step. This is the south of Europe, the north of Africa. We're talking about Spain territory, Morocco territory. We are now facing the same problem of an invasive alien species with one disease, pandemic disease, which is called Phytophthora cinnamomi. Phytophthora cinnamomi is the acorn tree's drawback. It's destroying all of our ecosystems. In addition to Sierra fastidiosa with the olive trees, it's a disaster. But we're sharing it with different geopolitical, but similar ecological forces, these projects. This is the big issue, the big thing of using open source virtual research standards from which we can provide the proper remote sensing tools. Let's go a little bit further there. But taking into account the importance of the metadata catalogs, how we guarantee from the ecological point of view, and we're talking about limnologists, hydrologists, edaphologists, different chapters of biodiversity and preservation, the citation, the metadata catalogs, the training catalog of the people, the capacity building to the people to, who are supposed to use this. I remember you, Kalin remind you, researchers, decision makers, citizen scientists, entrepreneurs. The semantic approach of what we are referring to, what about the persistent identifies to identify the data and to have a clear perspective of the data we're talking about in an univoc way without any depth of what we're considering. That's why we are key partners of the European Open Science and both, and also Research Data Alliance. And then when we go to everything and we're composing the services, how we can use artificial intelligence and big data tools. For instance, with FAO, we're collaborating in all what is related to forest with accuracy of almost 70% for remote sensing studies. Our colleagues Lorenzo from Brazil, Alcaraz Segura from Granada here in Andalusia. How we can use this remote sensing, these open source tools, to provide faster identification of cetaceans, whales, these special detections. And last but not least, for instance, one of the key issues we're dealing with is an internal joint initiative of non-indigenous and alien species. We're talking about the detection of artificial reef monitoring system, Atlantus altissima, that is a bad weeds, we used to say bad weeds, affecting northern ecosystem, a lacting ecosystem in Europe. Omnivorous invasive crustaceans, we are talking about the blue crustaceans, the blue crab, the macroalgae tassifolia, and the Cylindrea cumurae, which is an exotic algae coming from Asiatic areas, affecting South America and Europe, and changing drastically, and not for good, precisely, the ecosystem there, the biotopes in general terms, and the Mediterranean forest, in the case of Amphitrite cinnamomum, as I could tell you before. These are results, open resource, free, open developments that you can access through our web page, web portal. Of course, there's a mechanism of accession. You send us an email, we will grant you, you will have this access to these services. Where remote sensing is essential. For instance, here, this is an example, some snap captures of the screens in which we are talking about crustacean problems in the Mediterranean, in basin, or how being basin in situ observatories, citizen science, surviving DNA, and remote sensing primary observations, we are identifying, previously being based on biodiversity models, the species distribution and the essential biodiversity variables. My friends, the EVBs, in particular in collaboration with our colleagues from the University of Amsterdam and the University from UVA and our colleagues from Leiden. And the reports units in countries and ecoregions in order to define the future possible scenarios as a way to have biodiversity change indicators. So we are forecasting what is going on to happen in that ecosystem services. And of course, remote sensing and open standard of remote sensing and Earth observation assets are essential to get these objectives. And we are using blockchain system in all of this in order to guarantee traceability, anti-tampering, and provide the proper socioeconomic tokenization of those ecosystem services. This is a video. I will not play the video because it took 2 minutes how the blockchain is working, but I think you know better than me how it's working. But for instance, one of the samples we're using is about the socioeconomics valorization jointly with Jebif of the Pseudorasbora, I will try to pronounce well, Pseudorasbora parva, that is an invasive valley species coming from Asia. You can see here the map throughout all the continent, the European continent. And how we can, and this is, we are working right now for information. So I will stop this one. Well, this is making strange things as a second minute because I have embedded the video within the PowerPoint and I hope it's not crashing.
I don't think we're going to have time for a video, I'm afraid, Juan Miguel. We're getting close to the end of the session, and I want to make sure we've got a little bit.
I'm finished. So I was a little bit scary because, video, Microsoft, don't tell a lot.
So I will wait, cerrar el programa. So I will open again, no problem.
Microsoft is not responding as usual. Wow, I am open source defender and I'm using today because this is our office desktop laptop for the traveling, you know, PowerPoint. But I'm finished. Now I'm going to again open, no problem. I'm almost finishing because I will go to the point of remote sensing. I wanted to have an enthusiastic presentation in order to get the people, users, just you to collaborate with us because.
Yes, you've shared a lot. You've referenced some really big global collaborations and European collaborations.
We believe in collaboration. That is the only hope for our to save our planet. But I think we are convinced knowledge, open knowledge is the only way forward.
So if we zoom in on the open source aspects of what you're trying to establish, open source for geospatial, VRE, what's the best way for people to engage with you?
Yes, I will tell you because I'm one of the founders of the open source movement here in Andalusia, in the so-called Linux, Wada Linux. Maybe you have heard about that. We have given service to 3 million children, people worldwide during the last years, based on open standards. Well, I will go to the United Nations. You know, there were several after the video, biodiversity and ecosystem platforms who were collaborating. You already do NOSA, United Nations, linking space and wildlife community in Latin America and Caribbean, Africa, but in particular, because it's very important to take into account the multi-component approach to nature conservation and management in times of rapid change, where scientists, nature managers, and policymakers must be done. I invite you to go to EcoPotential project that you, one of the Lightwatch Eric related projects, which resorts we are integrating. Open source, my friend, research, they are available there, but we're integrating the virtual research and our winter research environments, EcoPotential project. But by the way, I will share for free, openly, my presentation, of course. And I would like to contact you from now on, all my team at your disposal. That's our work for pressure. All the relationships between land surface temperature, the LST, and anomalies, the difference vegetation index, with some spectacular, let's say, the NDVI results for the spatial and seasonal patterns in vegetation, ground emitting in Europe. This can be extrapolated or transferred worldwide as well. This is our remote sensing with open standards. We are working with the critical zone, is the earth skin living where rock meets life, because it's very important to understand that these open developments are dealing with a place where physics, chemistry, hydrology, ecohydrology, geology, and biology closely interact. And this must be open source as well. We are applying the deep learning and Sentinel NDV to protect habitats under the Wider Framework Directive, the European. Here is one of our publications. We're talking about how we use very high resolution images plus convolutional neural networks to establish precise shrub maps in Africa with a high cost. We will provide you the links to the resources step by step.
Thank you, amiga.
Outstanding performance locally and far away, interfering groundwater, deep learning system automatically count megafauna from space with an international team of 76 people. Here you can see some of their faces. It's not about only Spain, it's Italy, Greece, the Netherlands, people in Argentina, in Mexico, a lot of places, Korea.
We actually have a question for you from one of our audience members in Argentina about how they can get in touch with you to collaborate.
Of course, these are our coordinates in touch. Why? Because Argentina is very important from the EULAC, European Union collaboration, European Union, Latin American Caribbean cooperations. It's very important. We are now collaborating with them in what is called the Alianza del Pastizal, Rio de la Plata, in collaboration also with Uruguay, Bolivia, Paraguay, all these countries, Paraguay, Chile. And we are very eager for cooperation. In fact, I would like to invite you to the United Nations General Assembly, 76th edition, General Assembly edition, dealing with Sustainable Development Goals 14 and 15, that is life underwater, life on Earth, that is going to take place the day after tomorrow, October 1st, at 1 or 7 p.m. And I would like to tell you a key message. We have right now the best generation ever with the best skills on ICT, on open source developments. We are training there. We must foster cooperation. Please be free of contacting us to start these new projects. There's a new NDCI, Neighborhood Development Cooperation instrument to be granted, very well granted by the European Union. And now we have an excellent opportunity to foster collaboration on open source development to preserve biodiversity and ecosystem research. And like what Cherry has, Johnny Disco, JBIF, and all the research infrastructure, sister research infrastructure, we got the mission to do that. And we need you. We need you.
So on that call, we need you. Sadly, we need to wrap up our session. But Juan Miguel, can people contact you via the website? Is that the best way for people to reach you at the Eric LifeWatch Eric website?
Yep.
Fantastic. Then we send people that way to connect with all of these amazing initiatives.
For this meeting, and I will tell you something. We are not optimist. We are enthusiast. There is a difference.
Thank you.
We believe in people. We believe in data. We believe in interoperability between the people, the data, the researchers, and the psychology, emotional psychology of the people. Because after this lockdown, what we have learned is that enthusiasm and the reasons to live with this generation is the best ever we got.
I think you've got people in the audience going, here, here, yes, yes.
Yes, Orlando, because I'm Andalusian from the south. No, I'm Andalusian. I always say I must go down to another meeting. But this, but take into account that this is not the blah, blah, blah to have a good justification in this meeting. No. The good thing is to take into account. Please take my coordinates. Let's work together. E-research collaboration is essential.
So there we have it. A call for collaboration, policy, a rallying cry.
See, but you know, policymakers in Brussels, policymakers in the United Nations, blah, blah, blah. And now we go to the open source community. With the best ever developments, we can do that. Of course, I cannot employ only half an hour to explain about all of the things. We do our GitHub resources. We will collaborate based on Creative Commons license. Of course, that's not.
I think if we had given you a full day session, you still would not have managed to cover all of the things that you could share with us. So we're very pleased that you could make it to the end of our session. Sadly, we need to wrap up. But I hope that you're around for more of the conference and people can continue to connect with you and look for ways to collaborate together.
Of course.
And I'd like to thank once again all of the speakers that joined us for this session. It's been a really fantastically interesting session. I hope that all of you watching from home or office spaces have enjoyed it as much as we have here at backstage. I'll ask the speakers once again to wave a goodbye to you all. Thank you so much and have a great rest of your conference.
Danke, Bell. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias. Ah, tschüss.